Hi, welcome to Remade in America. I'm Pat Pattison. This is a show about adaptation, reinvention, and transformation. Tools you can use to launch a creative second career or simply stay relevant in your existing career. My guest today, Robert Carpenter, is a NASA scientist turned Philharmonic musician. He's going to tell us his journey and how he remade himself along the way. Stick with us. Welcome to the show.
Well, thank you.
Thanks for being a part of this.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
We have to notice, I appreciate that we are among a tree of tubas.
Yes, where I'm the most comfortable.
Which is totally appropriate for you.
That's right. Yeah,
mainly what I want to talk about is this incredible journey you've taken of being a scientist, NASA engineer, and then how you evolved into this incredible music career. Can you tell me a little bit about when you started knowing that science was a love for you, a passion?
Sure. I was actually one of those a classic scientist kids who took things apart.
Were you going to use the word nerd?
Nerd. It's okay. I was a nerd.
Okay.
I still am.
I don't want to throw that
it's
on
okay.
there.
It's okay. I can take it, actually. Yeah, I was a science nerd as a kid and took things apart and sometimes got them put back together. And that was okay. And I also started up a love of music at an early age. So I kept doing that.
You never blew yourself up or... Took a few windows out?
Or? The girl across the street used to call my parents and say, he's lighting stuff on fire.
That's
lighting.
Great.
But
call the fire department.
That's right. I wanted to see what color it would turn. So
that's why I light things on fire. What color is it going to turn?
That's right. That's right. Absolutely. So that was my childhood.
Okay.
Ended up at Northwestern because I was also playing the tuba in high school and was friends with some of the symphony players in Orlando at the time, and they encouraged me to go study with Arnold Jacobs. And Arnold Jacobs was the preeminent, tubist and instructor.
So you had some mentoring.
I did.
Sounds like
I did
early on.
I did have mentoring.
Yeah.
But even they were telling me, stick with science. Don't ever give that up.
Okay.
And that was good advice.
Right.
That was good advice.
Yeah. You had mentors that lived in the real world.
Exactly right. Yeah. Exactly right. And it's one thing to have mentors who have all made it, to have mentors who are made it but struggling,
Or have had to do what a lot of creative people do, which is the day job.
That's
and
right.
And then I get my enjoyment out of whatever else I can create in the spaces between the day job.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's exactly right.
When you started your science career, what was your primary motive?
To be honest, when I started my science career working with NASA, my motive was making enough money to eat and stuff.
Yeah, like a lot of people.
Like normal people. I was out of college, didn't know what I was doing.
Yeah.
I really didn't know what it meant to be an engineer.
Okay.
I was fortunate at that point.
Okay.
I lived in Orlando, and the Space Center is an hour away to the east.
Right.
And I got a job, which was not easy to get, with NASA.
So they shoot a lot of things off of that Cape Canaveral.
It was a great blending of all my love of fire and taking things apart.
The ultimate Roman candle.
Oh, it's a huge hobby. Think of it. I mean, as a kid, I was playing with little model rockets, like any normal nerd. And here I was able to... this was a candy store.
Wow.
This was a bigger-than-life candy store.
Wow.
With my job, I got to visit every square inch of the shuttle.
And the learning curve to get to that job, was it steep?
It was a wall.
Okay.
There's nothing that could prepare you because it was all so specific. Okay. It took me a year just to learn the acronyms. I mean, you walk in, you talk and code. So I had to learn how the shuttle worked, and I had to learn how the launch process works. It was fantastic.
And your entree was serendipitous, hard work. What do you think?
It was Serendipitous and tenacity. I had to be very tenacious to get this job. But what happened is I was unemployed, and I was playing a German band job with a tuba because I needed
polka?
To make some money. Polka. I was wearing lederhosen, doing the whole thing.
I love it.
So wow. The leader went and hired an accordion player, came in. Hey, how you doing? What are you doing? I said, well, what do you do during the day? Are you a professional accordion player 24 hours a day? No, he was a scientist at NASA. And he's the one that told me, there's some people hiring out there.
Out of a polka.
Out of a polka, yeah.
So that's just too much.
Yeah. There's a lesson in
wow.
there. There's a lesson in yeah. there. And the lesson is to talk to people.
Yeah. Networking.
That. Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I wasn't talking to him expecting I was going to wind up with my career out of it. But
wow.
it did, but that's what happened.
That learning curve and then that pivotal.
That was the pivot point that got me into.
I always say it's being in the right place at the right time. But doing the right thing.
That's right. If you don't give yourself a chance, then...
Yeah. But you have to be prepared
uh-huh.
to take that...
That's right.
...that moment. I know you've got a family, so is this happening concurrent?
This was a post-marriage, pre-kids.
Okay. Okay.
So I was fairly flexible at the time, and
right.
the job was hard. As much fun as it was and exciting
yeah.
as it was, the space shuttle's like a small child. It never sleeps. And so we had to cover 24 hours a day. So I'd work during the day, then for a couple of weeks. And
it's like being a
I'd work at night,
surgeon.
And I'd work in the middle of the night.
Wow.
You know, so it was about a third of the time I was there in the middle of the night. And, I mean, there's so many exciting stories of all of that. And the launches were incredible
right.
and all that. But, you know, one of the little transformation periods for me was realizing that I didn't think I could keep that pace and be a dad. I mean,
okay. And that kind of takes me into my next stage that I call the hourglass moment,
uh-huh.
when you kind of notice your own life's hourglass and you realize there's only so much time.
That's exactly
that
right.
I have, or that I have remaining, or however you want to look at it. And did that seem to kind of happen for you in terms of an awareness, like with the kids?
Very much so.
Okay.
Very much so. And that's where you start to treat every minute.
Yeah.
With a little bit more care.
Yeah.
And you begin to question whether it's worth the driving
right.
that you're doing for that, or worth the stress that's for
yeah.
that. And you reassess based on
yeah.
on that. On
it circles back around to your motives.
It does.
Why am I doing something?
Exactly.
Yeah. The transition that came out of that, it was kind of a second discernment, a second awareness in terms of how to adjust your life?
There have been a few.
Okay. Yeah, like most of us.
Yeah, there have been a few. So, yeah, that was a transformational, pivotal period where I realized I needed to make a change.
Okay.
And so you keep your eyes open and look for the opportunities that would be what makes sense for
that a space shuttle orbiting engineer / tuba player would have. I mean, there are a dime a dozen.
They're all over the place. There are a few musicians out there.
Yeah.
They hired a lot of musicians
yeah.
because of the way musicians think, actually.
Right.
So
you had that second discernment, and how did that adjustment happen for you?
There were two adjustments that happened concurrent.
Yeah.
One is that the Orlando Philharmonic came into being, and it was a transition for the orchestra. The old orchestra went out of business. It became insolvent, and the Orlando Philharmonic grew out of ashes. It's very, very healthy now. It's got a pretty decent season, and I won the job. You know, I figured, well, why not? Let's do this. That's that whole thing about
lucky paths diverge.
Right, and
yeah.
you look for the opportunity, and there it is, and you take it.
Yeah. And what exists in my backyard.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot there. I've been thinking about transforming in place. It looks like I haven't transformed at all. I'm still living in the same town.
Yeah, right.
But I've gone through tremendous changes and gotten to do a lot of different things.
You know,
things.
Some of that about the place you're in is great. I'm glad you brought that up. I'm reading a book right now. It's called Repacking Your Bags, and it's a guy named Richard Leder and David Shapiro, and he has the definition of a good life, and I'm going to read it real quick.
Yeah.
It's living in the place I belong with the people I love, doing the right work on purpose.
That's great.
Isn't that a good one? And it sounds like you have a place there in
yeah.
Orlando.
Yeah.
Obviously your family,
yeah.
people
right.
you love.
Right.
And
right.
You're living the good life.
I am. I'm incredibly fortunate.
Isn't that great?
Yeah.
With that kind of transitional move, was that a hard thing to let go of?
Yeah.
That prestige?
It was hard. It was hard to let go of the prestige and the shuttle, for crying out loud. Yeah. You know, it's bigger than
people
life.
People saw you on TV and whatever.
Oh, I was in the control room with a headset on, being one of the last people to talk to the astronauts before they would launch.
Wow.
I did all kinds of cool stuff. It was
wow.
So yeah, that was a, that was
that high pressure? Was that?
It was high pressure.
Yeah.
The focus is so intense.
Yeah.
On, I mean, you basically have a bomb sitting out there. It's
yeah.
loaded full of fuel. And
yeah.
One of the more exciting times that I had was walking into the firing room at 1 o'clock in the morning to take my position and work on a launch vehicle. It was going to launch at 8 o'clock the next morning. And I walked in and a half hour after I'm there, all the data went away. And I was in charge of data. Data all float through my console. And there's alarms going off. And it's just a little nightmare going on. And it's time-based, so it's very scary. And we had to troubleshoot and find out why the data was gone. You're not launching without that. And, there's thousands of people involved point. And the TV's on, and it's a big deal. So,
yeah.
So.
And your name keeps coming up.
Yeah, well.
What is Robertson? What's Bob? No.
No, it's
why. Did he screw this up?
No, it's classic. Even in the movie Apollo 13, it's probably instrumentation. That was
okay.
My group. I
yeah.
worked for instrumentation.
Wow.
So it was instrumentation. It was our yeah. it was our timing unit. It had a cable that came loose and it was rattling around and causing all the synchronization of all the computers to go. So, but it took us a couple hours to figure that out and. Of troubleshooting, have people running into the cockpit. It was crazy.
Wow. And you started out this very young, right?
I did. This was my first job out of college. I was
wow.
So I was only 23 years old at the time when I was given control of the space shuttle.
Wow.
You know, of the instrumentation on the space shuttle here in a control room and, preparing it for launch and setting everything up for launch and on launch teams.
One of my favorite quotes is John Glenn up in one of the Mercury capsules saying, you know, you're up there floating around and you suddenly realize this thing was built by the lowest bidder. and college kids are
and college kids are flying it. Yeah.
That's funny.
Who knows what they were doing last
yeah.
night, right?
Yeah, that's amazing. Was some of that in terms of letting go of that replaced by the fulfillment of the creative end?
It was, and it was fulfilled on the creative end from both jobs.
Okay.
The symphony music, it was interesting. The symphony music, it's pretty exciting.
Yeah.
You know, and it's time-based, kind of like the shuttle was, you know. And opera, you know, a lot of people describe it as, an hour of boredom with a few minutes of terror. Because,
right.
Yeah, because at some point you have this very difficult passage and the conductor's pointing at you and you
right.
have to do it.
Right. The theme of the show being kind of reinventing and transforming our careers, you know, the financial end is always
right.
important, and I think everybody has a different path, but I think there's also almost a spiritual side to this.
Very much so.
You know, that maybe, you know, you kind of just have an inner voice that's guiding you. I don't know resonates for you. Or?
Sure, there are symptoms. There are symptoms that are given to you that it's
yeah.
time to start thinking.
Okay.
You know, and when I realized that I was on a launch and it was not as exciting as it used to be.
Okay.
When I realized that I had done the same test over and over again and I needed to learn something new. I have a love of learning. I like to do different things.
You bring up a good point. I mean, as you transitioned out, how did you keep up in terms of your information and your own education? Did you have to go back and get any schooling or?
No, there's no schooling for some of this.
Okay.
This was cutting edge
okay.
stuff. Well, back up. The first thing I did was I was honest with the Army employer, said, you need to know while I was interviewing that I play in a symphony orchestra.
Oh, good for you.
And
which it's important to you.
It did. And
it led to
really living by core values,
yeah.
you know, which is kind of the thing you can hang on to when you're making a decision.
If you make me give this up, it's going to be short term because I'm going to be miserable.
Right, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
So I went from space shuttle operations to microelectronic fabrication and wow. testing for high shock.
And more recently, that fabrication expertise has been combined with your passion for music.
That's right. And here's a decent transformation for you too. Is I had kept music and engineering mutually exclusive.
Yeah.
Really, kind of on purpose. I really didn't want them to commingle. You know, because I would go do this, and I could go do this, and
right.
you know, a friend of mine who was a patron of my orchestra, fellow who's also a food scientist and also a amateur tuba player, so
wow.
he's kind of similar. We wound up talking about the tuba manufacturing industry and started asking each other, why can't you buy a tuba that sounds like the two tubas that the Chicago Symphony Orchestra owns? They're made by a company called York.
Yeah.
So we decided, right then, let's figure it out. This will be fun. And started doing some real, honest to God, scientific research on the tuba, which I'd never done before. I just played the darn things.
Sure. Yeah.
And so I bought an old beat up York tuba off of eBay, and we cut it up.
Wow. Autopsy. You did an autopsy.
We did an autopsy. That's right. So we
forensics.
Forensic science. So we sent some samples to a laboratory and had a mass spectrometry readout of the components
the
of the metal.
Metallurgy.
That's right. Was... And sure enough, it's not the right metal.
Wow.
And then we did research on builders as okay. well and found that, you know, the York Company had a fellow named Bill Johnson who was their shop foreman, and F.A. Reynolds worked for him. And after F.A. Reynolds was Zig Canstall, who learned from F.A. Reynolds. So we called up Zig Canstall, kind of a cold call. It went something like this. Hello, we're two crackpots in Orlando, Florida, and we would like to do an experiment.
And he bit.
He bit.
Wow.
When we started talking with him, he remembered some things from 50 years ago
wow.
about manufacture.
What are the odds?
So this became the reinvention of a lost art, a lost capability.
Wow. You don't have the Zildjian thing where it was passed from generation to generation, the magic metal formula got lost
right.
somewhere along the line.
Right, that's yeah. what happened. Beyond materials is the process that he actually makes the things.
Okay.
He uses a process of spinning and things, the metal that,
right.
that nobody else does. So where it is, he has several different lines of tubas that are going. The Boston Symphony owns a tuba with our bell on the tuba, and
wow.
We've done so much testing and so many people are involved, it's really, really working.
That is incredible.
Right.
So tell us a little bit about kind of what is special about this particular tuba.
Well, this particular tuba is it's a large tuba in a key of F that Zig Canstall designed and developed using our processes and our bracing help. And
right.
It's got a different color. It's kind of a rose-colored
it's
metal.
It's gorgeous. It's amazing.
Very pretty. And this metal is a little more dense than some of the other metals, and it's very hard, so it makes very special sound.
But give us a couple of notes.
All right,
I want to
yeah.
hear it.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, well done.
Hey, thank you.
I love it.
Yeah.
So one of the things that kind of I love about your story is this integration, you know, and the fact that, you know, like we talked a little bit about, your motive shifted a little bit maybe later in life.
Uh-huh,
you know,
that's right.
Did you find a moment when you kind of got a little more purposeful about planning what you wanted to achieve than maybe seat of the pants kind of when you were younger?
Very much so. Very much so.
Okay.
Yeah, when you're in your 20s and you're a kid, you know, it's a reactive thing.
Right.
And it makes sense because you don't really have that much life experience to know how to plan
right.
necessarily. People can tell you, but you don't listen. I didn't.
Yeah.
And yeah, so, you know, you start to get a little bit older and you realize that there's that much of the clock left and less of this. So every minute really counts
right.
in my mind. And along the way, I learned some great management techniques and some leadership techniques. one that really sticks with me that I use every day is I've established my own core values.
Okay.
You know, so my make my decisions based on these have to be met.
Is this fitting this?
Yeah, I have to be honesty, integrity, compassion, okay. and excellence.
Okay.
Those every decision I make has to include those things.
Yeah.
And yeah,
every. And it can't be flat. It's got.
It can't
yeah,
be flat.
Yeah, it's got to be in tune.
yeah. No, don't be.
The
flat.
Life has to converge and be in tune.
Right. It has to be natural.
Okay. There we go.
It's a pun
Not
there.
Be flat.
Right.
Yeah. And so, as you kind of made this more specific plan. Did execution be scare you at all, or did you embrace it?
At first, it was scary.
Okay.
Everything was scary, and then I realized there's no point in having fear. For crying out loud, you have to you trust in yourself, you trust in your capabilities, you trust in your friends, and you go move forward. When you get rid of fear, when you quit worrying, all that energy that you were spending being fearful and worrying is now directed towards getting towards your target, towards your goal, and
right.
you've now doubled your power.
Right.
You know, so your chances of failure are diminishing because you're doing a better job and thinking more and
right.
more purposeful, as you said.
Yeah. And I always, you know, in terms of kind of the stages I see in this, the last one being, and executing and enjoying.
Yes.
You know, and are you in the enjoying stage, you think?
Very much so. The fact that we did this, that we dove into this project,
yeah.
I've made new friends.
Isn't that great?
I've made a million new friends, and I've solidified.
And who knew? Came out of total blue sky.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. It did, except that you allow it to happen.
Yeah. Right.
You put yourself in a position
yeah.
and allow it to happen, and you're right. So I've met all these people. I've strengthened these relationships with old friends.
Tuba pals.
Friends. Yeah.
Tuba. This tuba cult that's going on.
Oh, it is. It is.
So, Robert, I really appreciate you being on the show. I mean, your story's incredible. I mean, I love all that you bring together in terms of moving in these stages of development of remaking your life.
Oh, gosh. Well, thank you so much for having me. What a pleasure.
Thanks for being with us. So join us next time for another story of adaptation, transformation, and reinvention. I'm Pat Pattison. Thanks for joining us.